afternoon. Welcome to the 2020 season, indoor season of Walden Bay. This is our 65th year of making music for the community of Walden. Our signature piece for this season is Strike Up the Band, written by George and Ira Gershwin from a musical. And the arrangement that we're playing is by Warren Barker, who manages to very cleverly include quotes from several famous marches into this arrangement. So without anything further, let's start our 65th season of the Warwick Band.
Thank you.
Our next competition, the bid is Gilbert and Sullivan in an entirely different way than what you usually hear. Charles McCarris was an oboe player with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. And he struck up the acquaintance with John Crankle, who was a well-known English choreographer. And they both were discussing how they really enjoyed the music of Gilbert and Sullivan. And one of them came up with the idea of creating a ballet using the music of Gilbert and Sullivan. Arthur Sullivan never wrote music for a ballet, so this was an entirely new opportunity. So they took excerpts from many of the Gilbert and Sullivan operettas and stitched them together, and they found a story by Gilbert that had never been made into an operetta, and they used that as the basis. The name of his ballet is called Pineapple Paul, and Pineapple Paul is the name of one of the characters. At the seaside naval base, Paul is the most beautiful girl in the entire city. And Jasper, who works at the local grog shop, just sweeping up and taking care of things, is in love with her. But Pineapple Paul is impressed by the daring captain of the local naval frigate. And at the end, everything works out. Because the captain gets promoted to admiral and has to go to London, and Jasper, somehow or another, gets his uniform. Now he's the captain, and of course now Paul is in love with him. So ladies and gentlemen, here we have four dances from Pineapple Paul, music originally by Arthur Sullivan and W.S. Gilbert, and it was arranged by Charles McCarris, who later became a very, very well-known English conductor of orchestra. Here we go.
Thank you.
Hall, music of Arthur Sullivan, Jason Bonatoria, WSU. Now, we have something really special for you. We're going to feature as a solo instrument, an instrument that we have not used as a solo before. And this is an instrument for the alto flute. Now, we all know the flute, and we all know the piccolo, which is a small, very high pitch flute, but there is a lower flute, which we're going to be featuring on a composition by Emmanuel Charpentier, originally written for the French War. But today, Annette Leib is going to perform it for you on the alto flute.
Thank you. previously multi-instrumentalist. She also played
piccolo, often with us during our parades, and played saxophone as well.
And piano.
Oh, and piano. I didn't know that. This season, we decided to do something very unique. For the marches that we've chosen marches that were not written by John Philip Sousa. People think that he was the, well, he was the great march king, but there are a lot of march princesses and dukes and counts and barons out there. And we're going to, this season, play music by 12 of the other march composers other than John Philip Sousa. And the first one we're going to feature this season is Orin Farah, who wrote this poem, march called Bombasto, back in 1895. Passages. immediately prior to the American Civil War. That was one of the most popular songs of the Civil War with both the Union and the Confederacy. Now, in later years, it came to be associated with the American South. But today, once again, we're able to enjoy it for what it is. It's a rollicking good song. And in this arrangement, Richard Maltby has taken the melody, but he's cast it in an entirely different way. Usually, when we think of polkas, we think like of Jimmy Stern, and we think of Polish dance music, or German dance music, or Czech dance music. Well, there are polkas that are not actually intended for dancing. And this is one of those pieces. It's going to move you, you're going to tap your toes, and if you get up and dance up and down the aisle, well, I'm not stopping. So here we go, ladies and gentlemen, Richard Maltby's Dixie Polka. Of the invasion of Normandy
And in about a month's time, we'll be celebrating or observing the 75th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge. These World War II created what many people regard as our greatest generation. And there's still a few left today. But the greatest generation also produced a number of great musicians. They served in Army and Navy bands during World War II. And after World War II, they went to the finest music schools in the country, the Juilliard, Boston Conservatory, Peabody, Vanderbilt, and they burst upon the scene in the 1940s, creating an entire new wave, a new American sound of classical music. And the first piece on the second half is by one of these composers of the greatest generation. His name is Peter Manning. He's not as well known as some of the other composers, but he had a profound influence on music. In 1950, Edmund Michael Goldman commissioned him to write a piece for the famed Goldman Band, and this led to a number of other American composers writing great quality band music. The name of the piece is called Canzone. It's very interesting. It's chock full of energy. I wish I could give everybody here a set of this so that when it comes time to clean the house, or pull the weeds, or go for your morning walk, this music would inspire you to get moving. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the Canzone by Peter Manning.
Thank you.
far as breaking the law, I would be done by now. Several fourth solo parts on there, solo flute, next by Nancy Harwood. Fifth solo solo by Ken Parker. Also solo by Jimmy Bear. Now, every now and then, we're faced with a situation where something bad is going to happen. And if you think back to late 1999, everybody was talking about Y2K. Yes. Now, if you don't remember specifically what it was, a lot of people, or a lot of companies, thought that the computers would not be able to handle the date 2000, the year 2000. And there were all sorts of predictions of doom that the lighting grid would fail, that our microwaves wouldn't work, that airplanes would fall from the sky. Didn't happen. But nevertheless, people were still really, you know, concerned about that. You know, it's a little bit like when they talk about snow in Kansas, and you go and buy an extra loaf of bread. Right? It never gets to us. Well, the beginning of that, our current century, was a period of time that a lot of people wanted to signify in other ways than fearing that their computer was going to die. And the United States Army Band, as conductor Timothy Houghton, commissioned an English composer, Phil Spark, to write a piece. And we're going to perform it for you now. It's called To a New Age. And in this piece of music, it contains, you know, a great hope that the 21st century was going to be the best century ever. Who knows? Maybe it's still hot. Ladies and gentlemen, to a new dawn. on there, clarinet solo. Do you have any fresh water? We go to Shapiro again on the other side. And Nancy Horowitz again on. Every now and then, an artist comes along into the field of popular music and creates a career which spans half a century or more. Such was the case of Aretha Franklin, already well known as a vocalist in the late 1950s, throughout the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, and then even onwards. She continued to be the primary female singer in the world of soul music. She composed some songs, and other instances, she took other people's music and rocketed it to fame. And our next selection, which is entitled The Queen of Soul, is an homage to her. If you want to sing along, please do so, but not too loud. I don't want you drowning out there.
Thank you.
our major soloist on this piece was our trumpet, Katie Holston. And again on track, Mitch Shapiro. We come to our final composition on stage program. It is another Not My Suit of March. This time by a man whose name is James Fulton. And he was active at the beginning of the 20th century. And this march was written in commemoration or in honor of the launching of the battleship New York from Brooklyn Navy Yard in 1914. And the battleship New York served in both World War I and World War II, primarily in the Atlantic, serving its convoy escort. And the ship is still in existence today, but it's about 180 feet underwater. Because when they did the Bikini atomic bomb test in 1946, it was one of a series of older warships that were placed around where the bomb was detonated because they wanted to see the effect of atomic blast upon warships. And it survived the blast, but then it was radioactive. So they simply sank it. But ladies and gentlemen, we still have the Battleship New York March. And if you listen to it, you're going to notice it sounds a lot like the popular music of that time, particularly the music of George M. Cohan. So ladies and gentlemen, our final composition today, the Battleship New York March. Nothing came back. But then I realized that they had given out the punch and cookies while we were playing. Very nice powerful soul. Well, we do have one more for you, one more not by Susan March. And we'd like to thank you for coming here today. Our next concert is going to be on Super Saturday. That's right, Super Saturday, February the 1st. And at that time, we have again another wonderful program for you, a variety of music. We'd like to thank the Village School for allowing us to use this auditorium. Very nice, very comfortable auditorium. We appreciate the assistance of the Cupola, where we rehearse on Thursday nights over in Paramus. We are also grateful to the Berkeley College for printing today's program and helping us with our mailing earlier this year. And we are extremely grateful to you, Cupola. Because as I have said many times, it's fun playing music. But it's more fun if there's somebody there to listen to. So thank you for coming today. Very appropriately, our last march is entitled Lights Out. It's by Elvin E. McCoy. Written at the very beginning of the 20th century.